Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathashala for Food and Nutrition. Today we are going to speak about the ethics of clinical research involving human beings. I am Dr. Vasanta Muthuswamy. I was formerly a Senior Deputy Director General at the Indian Council of Medical Research, New Delhi. And I've been looking after the areas of ethics of animal and human experimentation. Today we are going to speak about what are the issues involved in using human beings for research and what do we mean by ethical issues, ethical code of conduct for research. All of you will be aware the word ethics is derived from the Greek word ethos, which means custom or character. That means what is the norms which we follow in life. And when we do the systematic study of values, human values for various activities to decide what is right and wrong in life. Okay, and this is what is determined by the code of conduct which is prescribed to us by generations so that we know that we have to always do the right things, not do the wrong things. And this is where comes the code of conduct. There are also laws which regulate the ethical behavior of human beings for various activities. These laws are prescribed by somebody, by the government, and they become mandatory, you have to follow. But the code of conduct is supposed to come from within, and we should know in our heart of heart what is right and what is wrong. The moral code of conduct which has been decided for various activities in life, whether it is a normative activity for day-to-day life, for whatever we do, or the various professionals, doctors, engineers, lawyers, administrators, politicians, each one is supposed to have a particular code of conduct. And how this is prescribed is based on certain philosophical basis or philosophical principles. And these are of course different from the laws which are there. We are here going to talk about the code of ethics for research, scientific research and the medical research. When we talk of code of conduct for professionals, here when we are talking of biomedical research, that is research in biology and medicine, so immediately you think of doctors. Is it the code of conduct for doctors the same as what is the code of conduct for researchers? Is there a difference between research and practice? This one has to be aware. What is practice? Medical practice is done by physicians, that is doctors. And what do they do? When the patients come to them with some illness and ask for treatment, the doctors give various interventions which are designed to enhance the well-being of the individual patient who has come to them. But what is research? No patient comes to the doctor for research. Research is done by scientists, by physicians, by various professionals to understand that there is a hypothesis which has to be tested, and for testing this we use the human beings, and that is what is research. So nobody comes to anybody for research, they come for treatment, that is practice. So naturally you can imagine that the guidelines which have to be given for the practice is something different from guideline which has to be given for the research. Now all of you are aware that when we are talking of the biomedical or scientific research, there are two components. One is using animals for experimentation, other one is using human beings for experimentation. Animal experiment is called preclinical research and the human experimentation is called clinical research. And what is clinical research? It's a systematic investigation in human beings, which is designed to produce a generalizable knowledge. So we do research to get new knowledge or to change the existing knowledge to see that what is the right position now. So it's a systematic way of doing it, and when we talk of human beings, what do we mean by human beings? We'll see later. When you look at the various participants in clinical research, there are certain regulators who say what are the do's and don'ts. There are sponsors who give funds for doing research. There are institutions where you have all facilities. There are investigators who actually do the research. Then you have your guide, your mentor who tell you, guide you what is to be done and how it has to be done. And there are ethics committees which go through the proposals, give their approval, give their suggestions. They may approve, they may not approve. They may ask you to modify, and they have all the power to do that. Now all these are part of the institutions. But are the people who are important in clinical research? Yes, they are very important. If there are no regulators, you will do wrong. If there are no sponsors, you have no funds. And the institutions And the people who are there don't take the responsibility, nothing can be done. But what is most important in a clinical research is what is there in the center of this triangle. That is, unless you have a patient or a healthy volunteer on whom you are doing the research, the whole clinical research will go waste. You can't do it. So the most important, the central player in a research is the patient or the healthy volunteers. Now, is that enough to call it a clinical research? When we are defining a clinical research, it is not only the human beings, their biological samples and the biological data, all these will come under the clinical research. If you go back to the history and see that how this research had started, you know, in the many years back in the early BC, they used to say it's not cruel to inflict on a few criminals sufferings which may be useful for multitudes of innocent people. That means if you want to help somebody to come out with a new diagnosis, new treatment, new vaccines, you have to try it on few criminals who are actually condemned to death, whom you make them suffer going through the test, is nothing wrong. This is the kind of an attitude which existed thousands of years back, before many centuries. If you look at the most recent research which has happened in the 18th century, where we have the first documented human subject research, which is the where Edward Jenner tested the smallpox vaccine on his son as well as the neighborhood children. Now, this was possible there that he had come out with a vaccine which he wanted to test to see, it's a cowpox vaccine which he wanted to test whether it will work in human beings. So he gave it to his own son and the neighboring children. That was done those days. Can we do that now? Just because it's your own son, can you use him for testing the drugs? There are other people like Johann Georg during the 18th century who said that to test whether medicine is working or not, he swallowed the different various medication first himself, saw that it is not producing any harm, and then gave it to others. Now, these things were possible in those days because those days there were no courts, no guidelines, there were no rules or laws, and there was implicit faith that people had in the physicians. So these things were possible, but now it is considered that this is, have we exploited the faith which people have in them as a physician to do things which cannot be done now because there are other considerations. And if you come much recently, is during the 20th century, what we are reminded and because of which we have new rules and regulation now is the experiments which happened during the World War, where the Nazi experiments which are done by the Germans on the fellow prisoners, and then the Japanese researchers who did on Chinese prisoners, various medical experiments which came into light after the World War was over. So if you look at some of the experiments were done in concentration camps which were highly criticized, there were seawater experiments where the prisoners were put, there were high altitude experiments where the prisoners were put in high altitude chambers, there were freezing experiments where the prisoners were put in ice water and then the experiments were done. And then after this, the end point of all these experiments were death. So after the World War, the war crime, these were considered as war crimes because these were innocent prisoners of war were used as a research subject. The War Crime Tribunal met in a place called Nuremberg in Germany, and they conducted what is called the doctor's trial in November 46. After the trial, the 15 doctors were sentenced to death. Many were given life sentences. What came out at the end of this trial is what is called the Nuremberg Code. So the Nuremberg Code is the modern first recorded code of conduct for researchers, and which was released in 1947, which had 10 points. You can say these are the 10 commandments of Nuremberg Code for doing research on human beings. And the most important point which came out in this code is the voluntary informed consent must be obtained from the participants or the research subjects before they are recruited into the research, and it is the responsibility of the investigator to do that. They can't just send somebody and say go and get a consent and come. Investigator themselves should take it. There are also other guidelines which have come in the code. It said that the volunteers have the right to withdraw at any time. They have experiments must be for the benefit of the society. One should avoid unnecessary injury, and only qualified scientists must conduct these experiments. This came out in 47. Afterwards, in 1964, the World Medical Assembly, consisting of all the medical hospitals and the medical associations in the world, they decided that they will bring out very clear-cut guidelines for the research which is being done by the physicians on patients, and that is what is the famous Declaration of Helsinki. Although it was released in 1964, this is undergoing constant changes. This has been revised 7 times, and there were many revisions have taken place, and the most recent revision happened in 2013 at Brazil. And this is one which is constantly changing, because code of ethics or a code of conduct cannot be a fixed one. It's a very dynamic topic. It keeps on changing. What was right yesterday becomes wrong today, and what was considered wrong yesterday may be considered right today. So it's a dynamic subject which keeps on changing. As a result, the Declaration of Helsinki also is undergoing constant changes. It is the Helsinki Declaration 1964 which said for the first time there has to be an ethics committee for review, which must be independent of the investigators, sponsors, and they should not be subjected to any kind of influence for taking decision on whether any research can be done or not done. So this is the beginning of having ethics committees. Now, after declaring Helsinki in 64, there was an anesthetist in US. Now his name is Beecher. He decided to look at all the research which have been done and published in various high impact journals, and so he found out there are 22 published medical studies which have been now published after the research has been done, which are presenting risk to the subjects, and many of them have been done without the knowledge or approval. So he wrote an article called Ethics and Clinical Research in 1966 in the New England Journal of Medicine. Now this article became so popular, and everybody who read that and found out what it's written in this article is, they said that these 22 research which was done, many of them were dangerous research. No informed consent was taken from the patients or the volunteers. Not only informed consent was taken, the use of coercion and undue pressure was used to make them participate. In many cases, deception was used. People were not even aware that they are in the research. And most of them had either no benefit or had very little benefit to those who participated. The risks were much more than the benefits. People were not even informed about the risks which can happen, the side effects which can happen, so they suffered a lot. When treatment was available, treatment was not given because they are part of the research. And most of these patients who were used for this kind of research were vulnerable people who were exploited, who had no capacity to say no, no capacity to ask questions. The most famous study of these, out of these 22, which had shattered the whole world and which became mostly discussed study, is called the Tuskegee Syphilis Study. What happened in this study? This study was conducted for 40 years, from 1932 to 1972. Study was conducted by the US government, US Public Health Department. When it was started in 1932, there was no treatment for a disease called syphilis, which is a sexually transmitted disease. So they wanted to study the natural history of this disease, what happens. So what they did was, they chose African American men, who used to be called Negroes at that time. Now these men were very poor, and they were not given any, they were not taken any consent naturally, and they were just studying the natural history of the disease. But the problem was that end of the 1950s or early 60s, penicillin was discovered, and penicillin became the treatment for syphilis. But still, these group of men who were part of this study till 72 were not given any treatment. And 72, some journalists came to know about the study, published it, then everybody were shocked that a government department can do this kind of study when a treatment was available for one group of men who were poor, who were the African Americans, and they were not given the treatment. So the whole world started criticizing, and so the US government appointed a national commission for that. They went through this, and finally they found out during this period of 40 years, 28 deaths have happened, 100 cases of disability happened, and there were 19 children were born with congenital syphilis. And so the commission came out with the report. So what happened here? There were lack of informed consent. The subjects and their families were put to risk. The vulnerable people were exploited. Deception was used because they were not told that treatment is now available. Still, we are not giving treatment. So information was withheld. And absolutely, it had no benefit to patients because they were progressing with their illness, even when treatment is available to the outside world. And many of them have died and became disabled. National Commission for the Protection of Human Subjects of Biomedical and Behavioral Research, they came out after this with the guidelines for the US, which is called the Belmont Report. So they gave a report of this entire study and came out with the national guidelines, which is called the Ethical Principles and Guidelines for Protection of Human Subjects of Research. This was released in April 1979. So you can see that all the code of conduct or ethical issues which are now talking these days for doing medical research or clinical research, or it can be scientific research on human beings, the guidelines have got a very recent history of only about 60-70 years. So it started with Nuremberg Code, Helsinki Declaration, Belmont Report. The principle of beneficence is to do good, because it says that there is an obligation to confer benefits when you do something, which has to, you have to prevent harm, and then you have to weigh the balance between the good and the bad, and then finally take a decision. That's what is the central theme of biomedical ethics. So this is based on the principle of beneficence. So many people say that the non-maleficence is part of beneficence. It's also said that in the moral life, the ultimately we have to see that what is the ultimate result has to be good. So the principle of beneficence is extended to the principle of what is called the utilitarianism, or the principle of utility, that ultimately you do only good, the result is expected result has to be good. In India also, same time, in 1980 was the first Indian guidelines which came out, which is a policy statement on ethical consideration involved in research on human subjects. This was released in 1980. So you can see that almost when the US was bringing out their Belmont report, in India also was ready with its guidelines. And it is expected that all institutions in the country which carry out any form of biomedical research involving human beings should follow these guidelines in letter and spirit, and because this is the basis to protect the safety and well-being of all the individuals who are participating in research. As I said, that ethics is a dynamic subject. It keeps on changing. There are new developments which have produced new concerns, new worries to the community to see that whether really the public is protected by doing these experiments. So the ICMR has been revising these guidelines. So after 1980, after 20 years, we revised the guidelines in 2000, which is Ethical Guidelines for Biomedical Research on Human Subjects. And then we revised it again in 2006, because by the time the word subject itself was considered unethical. So it was changed to human participants, and many new in between the issues which had come up were included in this. Now it's almost 10 years are over. So the ICMR is now coming out with the new guideline, which was ready in 2016 and it's going to be printed in 2017 as the latest guideline, which has many more new issues which are not there in the previous. So these are a set of guidelines. The human ethical guidelines undergoes constant updating and changes because of the newer issues which are coming, because of the new kind of research, newer type of illnesses, newer type of international collaboration, which make us feel that we have to keep on updating these guidelines. Now let us look into these basic principles, because when you do research, you are also doing research. You are going to the community, you are looking at the people, you are doing various types of research. We'll see that there are people who do research just by asking questions. There are people where you can give some interventions to them and you may even look at their data. There are different types of experiments. When you look at the principle, the most important principle, which is the principle of autonomy, is you treat individuals as autonomous human beings who have a right to decide for themselves whether they should participate in research or not. So you allow them to choose for themselves. And there are people who cannot take decision themselves. They are called the vulnerable groups. And for them, you have to have additional ways of protection so that they are not exploited. If you look at the principle of beneficence and non-beneficence, it is that your purpose should be to minimize the harm and to maximize the benefit. So when you are doing research, you have to see that minimum harm comes to the individuals, the benefit is more. And by chance any harm happens, you have to see that how do you take care of those harms so that they are very well taken care of and nothing serious happened to them. So you have to constantly look into a risk-benefit analysis and see that how do you do the risk-benefit analysis. You have to quantify the magnitude of the harm which can happen, and you also look at the probability of the harm, and then you put in a scale in a table, and then they see whether the potential risk is more or potential benefit is more, and then finally you decide as to which are the kind of research. So the ethics committees do this risk benefit analysis. They see that whether the risk is more, the benefit is more, and then they decide. The next principle is the principle of justice. What do we mean by justice? Justice means we have to treat people fairly. Every human being have to be equally treated. So when in a kind of research, you can't say that you use one group of people for research, the benefit goes to another group of people. That cannot be done, which has of course been happening for many years. Now they are very strict and they are very careful about it. on whom research is done, on whom the benefits are happening. So this is called the burden of research, and the benefit of research should be equitably shared. So what we do is, when you selection of patients, like the Tuskegee study where the African American poor men were used while the treatment was given to the others outside and the white men. So we cannot do those kind of things anymore. You learn to see that what kind of a selection you do so that nobody is exploited, especially the vulnerable groups. And then also you have to see that at the end of the study, if you think that your results are very successful, you see that how the benefit has passed on to the individuals and the community. So when you look at the medical research using human beings or their biological materials or their data, all these constitute a clinical research. There are certain issues which are general to all kinds of research, and there are certain issues which are specific to only some type of research. What are the general issues? That is, you have to do a benefit risk assessment, you have to take informed consent from the individuals, you have to see that how their privacy and confidentiality is protected. In case they are participating, they have to come from far away to participate in research, you have to see that you give them the proper payment so that they don't have to spend on their own. And if they are vulnerable groups, either they should not be taken for research, or if you are forced to use them, and then you have to see that adequate protection is given to them. In case some harm happens, they have a right to get compensation. It can be compensation in the form of treatment, in the form of some help, or it may be even financial compensation. So one has to be aware of that. During the time when they are in your study, they can also get other illness, and you have to be aware that how do you take control of this ancillary care, and what kind of advice or treatment should be given. And you have to see that distributive justice is done so that burden and benefit are equitably distributed, and that is also post-research benefit. And most important, when especially for doing studies related to food and nutrition, you go to the community very often. You'll have to see from the beginning how the community is engaged from the beginning, from the planning stage, during the study and after the study, how do you communicate the results to them. So these are the general issues. When you look at the specific issues, will depend on the kind of study which you are doing. If you are doing a clinical trial using some interventions, it can be drugs, a device, herbal medicine, new technologies. You may do epidemiological surveys, just go to the community, ask them many questions to find out what's happening, or you can do a public health research. There are many times you want to know the knowledge, attitude and practice of people to understand their socio-behavioral pattern. These are the socio-behavioral studies. Of course, human genetics is a big part of medical research, which you may not be very much involved in that, but that's a very big group. And then, of course, when you look at the biological material and the data, there are certain specific issues. How do you take consent? How do you protect those material? How do you make use of it? And then in case of humanitarian emergencies which are happening, where the research groups rush to the place to do some research, what are the precautions to be taken? Medical research and scientific research is a very big issue in the international area. India is a sought after country for international collaborative research. Many countries internationally, agencies want to come to India to do research with Indian scientists. And if that is so, you have to be aware of what are the procedures and rules to be followed so that you are not criticized that you have broken the rules of the country. So you must understand the international collaborative research, what are the ethical code that has to be followed. In addition to that, every researcher has to have a responsible conduct of research from the time you plan till you publish. So all these are part of the new guideline. If you look at any study, the universal ethical requirements are your study which you are planning should have a social value, it should have a scientific validity, the fair selection of subjects and community should be done, there should be favorable risk-benefit ratio, there has to be independent review, you have to have individual informed consent, respect for the subjects and the communities, and the collaborative partnership. This was released in 2003 by Ezekiel Emanuel from the National Institute of Health, USA, which is very well accepted by the entire world as the universal ethical requirements for doing any study. As you have seen that the twin pillars of protection in biomedical research, everybody is not aware of all these issues. If you take care of two things, then you can say that your study is ethically conducted. One is you have a good informed consent process through which you take consent of the participant. The other one is there is an independent review by an ethics committee who will take care of all the issues to see that the rights and welfare of the human participant is protected. And these two are called the twin pillars of protection. So you have to go through this to understand that what do you mean by the informed consent process, where consent is taken from a competent individual after giving information, and if they are not competent, you have to take additional care of them. And when it comes to ethical review procedures, you have to know that all proposals on biomedical research involving the human participants must be cleared by an institutional ethics committee. So every institution has to have an ethics committee, as per the guidelines given by the ICMR, and then according this committee will go through all the proposals. And if you look at the, it's a committee which has been formally constituted, and then they do initial review, periodic review, review of the final report. So it's a continuous manner they will do the review. Many people say that only if you have a clinical trials or big studies have to go to the ethics committee. It is not that. Whether it's a clinical trials, whether it is a even radiation imaging, if it is surgical procedures, medical records, there are studies in which you are involved mostly in the area of food and nutrition. You may be looking into medical records and to see what is the kind of a nutritional studies which have been earlier done, what is the output. You may look at the, some of the biological samples and do some tests. And most important is the epidemiological and social and behavioral studies which is being done. All these studies, every study involving either human beings, their biological material or their data has to go to the ethics committee for approval. Okay, so and these are all called clinical research. So clinical research is not just human beings themselves, it is also their biological material and the data. So the composition of the ethics committee is given as per the ICMR guidelines. Next. So these are the guidelines of 2000-2006. It is now in the process of becoming a bill, so that there is an act of the parliament by which this bill will be passed, and this biomedical and health research bill will be binding on everybody. Guideline is there for you to follow. There is no, it's not mandatory. But once there is a bill, it becomes mandatory that everybody has to follow this. If you don't follow, you can be punished. So it is in the process of becoming a bill. We started the process 2006. It should be out. All research, clinical research, should be registered in the Clinical Trial Registry India. It was established in 2007 by ICMR. In 2009, the drug controller has made it mandatory that all clinical trials, regulatory clinical trials, should be registered. The editors of the biomedical journals have said that unless you are registering in a CT, in the CTRI, that is Clinical Trial Registry India, your paper will not be published. And even as early as late as 2013, the Helsinki Declaration says that all clinical research should be in the public domain. Although it's called Clinical Trial Registry in India, all clinical research can be registered in the CTRI. All types of research, whether they are regulatory or non-regulatory, whether they are clinical trial or any other study, will be registered in the CTRA. So there is a website and you can just go, and there is a procedure for entering. The whole purpose is that whatever is being done is in the public domain, everybody knows, so that there is no unnecessary repetition of studies, and you will know that what the other people are doing in the rest of the country and the rest of the world. So that is what about the Clinical Trial Registry India. So this is just in glimpse, in a short, a glimpse of what is ethics and what are the requirements and what has to be done. I am sure with this you will just understand the importance of ethics of human research.